And we're gonna start back here now. Like I said, come up close. I got just a few quick announcements, and then we'll get rolling. First of all, just some thank yous. Really appreciate you making the time to come out this afternoon. And I know it's cold. I touched a piece of metal, and a piece of my skin fell off. And so that was kind of it's cold when that happens. So I also want to thank the Chamber, Regina Chamber of Commerce, for collaborating with us and doing a kind of a joint workshop over lunch. And the folks that helped set up as well on our team, Heidi kind of took point, but there was a whole bunch of folks, Jenna and others, who helped organize things and get the word out to everybody else. In a week from now, next Thursday, is the SCSA's, Saskatchewan Construction Safety Association's annual general meeting. That'll be in Saskatoon at the Travelodge there. It will be starting, it'll be opening with a lunch, starts right 12:45. Jenna, do I got the time right? Oh no, sorry, 11:45, don't come at 12:45, you'll miss the food. Yeah, it'll be all over. And but 11:45, Dr. Larry Rosia, President and CEO of Saskatchewan Polytechnic, will be our guest speaker there, so it'll be fun to hear from him. Another quick thing is that the last event here, over the lunch and this afternoon, is being recorded, video recorded. We've got a team here helping us with that. The intention here is we know not every leader in the province could be here. We really wanted to get the message out to people. We'll have this posted through our website, and you'll get a message either through Constant Contact or another means when that's posted on our site. I expect it'll be at least a couple of 3 weeks before it's all edited and posted up there. But I encourage you to share it with your teams, share it with other people, send the link to anybody that you think could benefit from it. And I encourage you that. So today was really more about the leadership, the management and leadership level of organizations. Our organization has been very much involved in educating and training people on particularly the fundamentals of safety management, having the tools available. But for the last little while, I've been feeling, and in conversation with others, there's a bit of a void that's been developing at the leadership level. Some of that's because our businesses have been busy for a while, and a lot of times we end up delegating some responsibilities away while we're focusing on operations and just not having the time to be able to focus on some of the critical elements of our operation, particularly when it comes to our people. So we thought it would be a really neat opportunity, and Kavis and I had chatted for several months about maybe doing something like this. And putting together this, and this might be one of something we might do a couple times a year, perhaps, to really talk to our managers and senior managers or developing managers of organizations. And why do we focus on that? I think when we talk globally, we don't necessarily have a safety problem. We have often a leadership problem. Like Kavis said, when you look at the depth of issues that happen in organizations, whether it impacts your bottom line, whether it impacts your people, whether it impacts your customer, whether it impacts your reputation, it all boils back to leadership in one way, shape, or form. And in our jobs as leaders, sometimes we mix up the job of correcting people and forget about the job of connecting with people. And if we are able to make that connection, the correction becomes so much easier to take care of because we've got the trust and relationship, and people understand why you're asking to do certain things. So I'm going to call Kavis back. And Kavis, you've got a little bit more on your heart. I think the structure for this afternoon, the whole idea was to have a little more intimate conversation. And Kavis, you're going to talk about an hour and you have a little bit of Q&A. You're not looking at me, man. I'm like, yeah. And that's good. You know what, we've been laughing for the last couple of days, and I forgot to tell them this. Oh. We were in Lloydminster about a year and a half ago, somewhere in there, maybe a little more than a year ago. It was wintertime in Lloydminster, and it was a group a little bit larger than this, and he was there for the day. And there's only two dark guys are bald in the room, and one woman got us mixed up. She comes over to me, like Kavis, and she wanted to talk to me. I'm like, I'm not Kavis. he's a tall dark guy over there. Oh, and she was. Only two black dudes in the whole place. I'm sorry. I'm supposed to be a professional. It's good for your mental health. So there we go. That's a safety point today. Anyways, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Kavis Reed.
I'm sorry, man. No. Guys, I'm going to tell you the other part of that trip that Colin immediately left out. We instantly hit it off. I mean, it was almost like a brother from a different mother kind of a thing. And that night, we got our hard drinks. We got some Coke, some water.
Some Coca-Cola.
Coca-Cola. Yeah. Man, we hit it hard.
We sat around a table with a lot of cards, a lot of cribbage.
Yeah, Carrie played cribbage.
Yes, we played a lot of cribbage, and then we went to the conference the next day. And like he said, there were only two black guys in the audience that are in the room, and I told him, I said, you know, we're gonna get mixed up. I mean, that hairstyle is just gonna give it away. So, no, I haven't said this yet, and I think this is the right form to say it. Colin, I just appreciate the last couple of days, and the reason why I just appreciate the last couple of days is because all too often in business, as a segue, as a business, we divorce emotions. We divorce that connectivity. It's hard not doing business with people you connect with. It's very hard. And I often wonder, and us MBA holders can probably do this study on it, is how many deals are struck in a social setting versus just struck in a boardroom. I would bet you the statistics would probably suggest more business deals are struck in a social setting. I don't think the big deals are done based on just a business marriage. I think the big deals are done in a relational marriage. I truly believe connectivity is a key to business. Connectivity with the individuals that are in the decision-making power, that are in the leadership structure, is critically important. So I appreciate the connection we've had the last year and a half. And yes, we do look alike. You're just the better looking half of it.
I'm a little more condensed.
and as a side, we've laughed. I came here under the guise of doing presentation, but there's a couple of football agendas I have. I'll take a few more riders with me, and I'm just kidding. Just kidding before you guys call the cops. Honestly, I'm so honored to be here with you guys and share with you something that I feel very passionate about. And yes, this is going to be probably a more relaxed presentation. This is probably going to be a more interactive relationship in terms of this presentation. And it is truly about going from zero to team and how we're going to get there. And before we do that, I have a couple of requests. And I already picked you out. You guys didn't know it, but I was in the backroom surveying. And I want this young lady right here with the glasses with, yes, who's posturing, if you could please come here. I want the strength and conditioning young lady that's gonna make me look better come up. And I want the young man right there that, yes, come on up. Come on down, the price is right. Yes, no particular order.
I'm first, though.
No, it's not about being first. First shall be last, and the last will be first. But this is about a connectivity. This is about understanding. This is about truly a team. I love movies. If the movies are from the 90s backwards, I love them. I can't get into the new stuff. I don't know why. But I can remember lines from movies like they're a part of me. One of my favorite movies was Navy SEALs. And we talk about zero to team. There was a scene in that movie where the team got together. Anyone remember that movie? When the team got together right before they were going on their mission, do you remember what they talked about? Come, stand up, say it loud and proud. Yes, come on, Bonnie.
Looking out for each other.
Looking out and protecting each other. But do you remember what SEAL Leader 1 said to the entire team before they were going on deployment? The night before they got together, it was raining. They were at the hangar and they were going through all the logistical checks. And he said, you have 23 hours before you report back. I want you to say right now to the team, if there is a financial issue, if there is a marital issue, if there is an education, if there is are any issues in your life, state them now, because we'll all put together and give you the money that you need. We'll all cry with you. We'll all go visit your wife to make certain everything is good. But as SEAL Leader 1, I want everyone's focus on the mission. Get rid of all of the issues. And when Colin said, would you talk about zero to team, I thought about that scene. I thought about men and women literally having each other's lives in their hands, and they were talking about being together, getting all problems solved, understanding what it truly meant to be a team. So we've created a SEAL 1 team, and we don't want to know your issues. Not enough time. But what I want SEAL 2 to do, and SEAL 3 and SEAL 4, I want you guys to get together. I want you guys to get together out there, not in our presentation. You got 5 minutes. And I want you to come back with your conclusive 5 principles at the most of what makes a high efficient team. What makes a high performance team? What makes a championship team? What makes a championship business? What is it that's gonna make you the best SEAL team ever? I want you guys to huddle up. Do you know her?
No.
Even better. Do you know him?
No.
Even better. You got 5 minutes. Clock already started. See you later.
All right.
I want you to do this presentation. You got 5 minutes.
All right.
Zero to team. Here's what I've been taught. Whenever you're in an environment and you're the new person and you're introduced into an ecosystem, make yourself be a part of it. Get to know people. Understand people. Make it about them. That disarmament thing. But when you make it about them instead of about you, guess what happens to you? You grow. When you make it about everyone else on your team, when you have an expectation for them, you grow, you succeed. Married guys, raise your hand. Yeah, married women, raise your hand. What's that marriage all about symbolically? When you see it, it's an interconnection. It's you're a part of him, he's a part of you. You function literally as an equal partnership on a team. That's the principle, the standing principle. Let's extrapolate that principle, making this high performance, high executing championship team. Let's say we're in a marriage. That's what it is. We're in a marriage right now because we're all together in this room. And if something were to happen and we're trapped in here, we're gonna have to work together to make certain we solve the problem. We're in a marriage right now. Let's make it a marriage. And when we take that vow of being a team, of being committed in that marriage, here's what this team's gonna do. Here's what this partnership is gonna look like. We're going to say that we're not giving ourselves an out. I think it were the Greeks that did it. When they attacked an island, they rowed over, and what did they do with the boats? What did they do with them? Pardon?
Burned them.
Say it loud.
Them.
Tell them why they burnt the boats.
There was no retreat.
There was no option out. We're in this together. We landed on the beaches, and either we're going to succeed or we're going to fail. But guess what we're going to do both of them with? Together. There was only one option. In any high-performing team, ladies and gentlemen, give yourselves an option, not options. Define what you want to accomplish and be all in. Be in that marriage. Don't give yourself an out. Burn the boat. I can't swim, so I would be, I'm done. Be all in. High performance doesn't mean your talent. I read that book, talent is not enough. Whenever a leader is trying to put together a team of just talented people, that talent never succeeds. Talent's not enough. It's not enough to go from zero to team with just a lot of talented people. Character, whatever happened to that one as a part of the team? Commitment. Compassion, caring, talent's not enough. When we're putting together a football team, high performing, we're not looking for the same talent, we're looking for different talent. We're also looking for high character. We're looking for people that are commitment oriented. We're looking for people that are willing to get on that boat and they know that the voyage across may not lead to a voyage back. They're all in. Zero to team. All in. If you're not all in, you're all apart. Zero to team. You're in a marriage. No way out. Work through it. My wife wears the pants in my family. I know that. She's the boss. I know that. But I know I got a voice. She gives me my allowance. I'm okay with that. I tell her how much I want, so I'm the boss when I tell her I need some money. But it's a partnership. It's a marriage. There's a commitment there. There is a compassion, a care. And that team becomes so efficient that she looks at me and I go, yeah, I didn't take the garbage out. I'll go right now and do it. Don't worry about it. She gives me another stare, I go, yeah, I forgot to do the dishes. I'll get up and I'll get it done right away. She gives me another stare and I go, why didn't he do what you asked him to do? Doesn't have to speak a word. Because we're in it. Zero to team. Are you all in it? Are you fully in it? Are you fully invested in that team, that high performing team? Are you? Are you SEAL 1, SEAL 2, SEAL 3, where you care about everyone in the group, that if they have a concern, that connectivity, they have a concern, we're in this together, bro. We're gonna work this out, Blake. Let's get it done. Is that your environment? When you're out on the site, when you're out in the workplace, are you looking out for each other? Are you committed to each other's welfare, well-being? Zero to team. I'm going to bring SEAL Team 1 in, and I want them who don't know each other. And you know the most beautiful part of their entry is everyone smiling. Ladies and gentlemen, they have 3 minutes to present why they're going to be a high-performing team.
All right, so we'll go here.
All right.
Is this working? Okay. So I'm going to introduce our team, and then I'm turning it over to SEAL team member two here to do the rest of it. My name is Barb. I'm with Raven Roofing. We have Sebastian, who's with the SCSA, and Jamie, who is with Metal Performance Training Center. So Sebastian's going to take it from here.
Some of these questions, please. Yeah. All right. Morning, everybody. Or afternoon. So we were prepped with the task to find the five key parts to what makes a great team. Is this even working? So we figured one of the first things would be to be in a trusted environment, right? We all work better when we can trust that we're around people we can rely on, that we're in a safe group, and who's going to criticize us, and it's an open, safe environment. There needs to be good communication, right, back and forth between team members to other key holders or stakeholders, just so that we're making sure we're on task and we're reaching the goals we need to reach. Sincerity within the group, that people want to be there, right? A team is always better when you have volunteers within the group that want to be on task, that want to be there, rather than being voluntold, as we so often are, right? All of us, we've all been there. There needs to be some synergy that we've heard so much about. I'm sure you guys have all heard about that. Just a well-gelling group that performs well together, maybe has some history together. And lastly, go ahead.
We kind of put down being empowered, so kind of have that empowerment or that engagement amongst team members to be able to be part of the team and kind of work together. That way there's not half the team having a buy-in or not wanting to be part of the bigger picture kind of thing. So those were our main five key points, but we kind of were indicating at the top there, as long as there's trust and kind of mutual respect amongst the team members, then you can effectively work together in a kind of a positive environment and work together for that overall goal too.
And I think the last thing is,
we said at the end that we shouldn't ever forget that as a leader, you're a member of the team on par with the rest of the team. You have a different role, like Kavis said, but you're a part of that team, so.
I give them a round of applause.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Oh, my goodness. Colin, why did you need me to come here?
We'll have a table in the back later.
Like, really? They just stole the presentation. Trust, communication, sincerity, synergy, empowerment. Wow.
Yeah. Sorry.
Seriously, man. I used to like Regina. Trust. Let's talk about trust. Let's talk about that all-powerful word, trust. We said it in the presentation earlier, said it yesterday, and I'll maintain it. Thank you guys for echoing that. Trust. I will follow you. I will follow you to the ends of the earth if I what? Trust you. Trust. If I trust you, I will believe in you. I will follow you. At the epicenter of leadership, and if you define it as we defined earlier, leadership is the management of people's trust. As a father, they're trusting me. As a pastor, they're trusting you. As a leader, they're trusting you. As a president of an organization, they're trusting you. They're trusting you. That's a big responsibility. That's what makes leadership a conscious act, not just a noun. It's now taken an organic form. It's conscious because I'm dealing with people's trust. Please. And when you have a trust bankruptcy, what happens to the organization? What happens to the team? It's gone. It's compromised. Don't get in that trust deficit. Don't make too many withdrawals from that account. because it is so hard to build up. I make it analogous to debit cards. Hate them. You know why? Because you work 60 hours a week to build up that bank account, and in just one purchase, because you didn't see it, it's gone. So is trust. That team, that marriage, that bond, that commitment to each other is tied together. Any chemist in here? I can't use that analogy. You're an academician. There are two types of bond, covalent and ionic. Covalent is about the sharing of an electron. And it is the toughest, the hardest bond to break. It is one that leads to nuclear fission and nuclear fusion that extrapolates and extracts so much energy because that electron is shared. That's the kind of bond we want you to create. That's the kind of bond you create, that covalent bond you create through trust. Key. Your second point, SEAL team, was communication. Wow. How do you communicate with your team members? What's your primary mode of communication?
I talk to them.
God. Wow. What's that? Is that something they used to do in the 80s?
Yeah.
In the 90s?
Yeah.
That's not a millennial thing, right?
No, it's not.
Wow. Do you actually write, too? You actually use pen and pencils, too? Okay. Oh, geez. Man, we're outdated. We have to get with the times. Our communication skills just doesn't cut it these days. We're bad communicators because we actually talk to people. If you want to see an organization collapse, try not clear communication. And anywhere you go, at any presentation you hear about team and organizational structure, what is going to come up? The big C. And what do we not pay attention to? The big C, right? We just think, oh, here he goes again. I've heard this once, I've heard it twice, I've heard it 1,000 times. Communication. Really, what is that? If you don't clearly communicate where you want to be and how you're going to get there, what's the purpose? If you don't communicate how we're going to resolve, how we're going to solve, how are you going to get anything accomplished? If you don't communicate, how? How? Tell me why communication is important to you, Ryan. In your organization, why is it important? What company do you work with, Ryan? Pardon? What's your vision statement? What are you guys aiming to do? Now, I'm not trying to put you in the spot. Let's make it a rhetorical question. Because I don't want your, you're the boss, or is your boss around? Is your boss around? Good. What's your vision statement? Why every day do you wake up and go to work? So I'm going to ask another question. Are you in a leadership role? So if I go and communicate to all those people that you're the supervisor of, and I say, communicate to me clearly what the vision, goal, and protocols are of your division, are they going to give me a clear and articulate answer back? Don't have to answer that question. Don't incriminate yourself. Does he work with you? Is he under your supervision? Not directly, but somewhat, right?
Well, just as far as the safety is concerned.
Are you absolutely confident, Ryan, that if Colin took me over to your company right now, we left you here, we speed down Albert Street, right? Not speed, safely get there. And we go there and we ask your people, communicate to us without certainty, they're going to be able to clearly communicate what you're thinking and feeling. Not confident. And I love you, Ryan, because guess what I've planted in your head? What? Say it, Ryan. The doubt and question. And if there's doubt or question, that there is that person or those people that don't have a clear understanding, what must Ryan do now? Make certain that there is absolute clarity in the message. As a coach, there has to be absolute clarity in the message. My favorite movie, A Few Good Men, what did he say? Are we clear? What was the response? Crystal. Not a hesitation. Are we clear? Is the message clear? Crystal. He had absolute confidence that that message was clear or what's going to happen. People die on that wall. If it's not crystal clear, someone's going to die on that wall. That's the gravity of the situation. That's the importance of communication. That is crystal clear. We understand we're on the same page with that? If there's any doubt, overemphasize, overcommunicate. Because the consequences are too great. You said sincerity. Who came up with that one? Which one in the SEAL team came up with that one? Sincerity. Wow, I love you guys protecting each other already. Did you guys exchange numbers? Jeez, I'm a bad matchmaker. Authenticity is easily picked up on. If you're not 100% authentic, if you're not 100% sincere, your leadership is compromised. It has to be a natural flow. People have to just stand by you and say, authentic. 100% sincere. She cares about me. She wants the best for me. 100% USDA inspected sincerity. 100% stamped by Inspector 12. Sincere. I know you're a sincere guy, Ryan. I know it, absolutely. Sincerity is key to attracting. It's truly a key. Truly a key. And if you're authentic and sincere, people are going to be attracted to you, right? It's the superficiality that people can see through right away. It's a synergy. I need help with this one. All right, help from a sense that defines synergy for me. I have very good eyesight, and I think is Dale correct? That's back there? Oh, man. I'm old, but my eyes are still good. Dale, help me a little bit. What is synergy? Stand up, please. Project it to the audience. You stand there, and I'm going to ask my friend right here, the academician, yes, you. We dine together. What is synergy? You're in judo. You're on teams. You're high performing. What is synergy to you? Stand up. You're handsome, intelligent, and fit. I envy. Hmm. Let's put a picture of synergy together. Let's paint a picture. Anyone watch Little House on the Prairie? Yes, I'm old. Okay, guys? Remember Little House on the Prairie?
I'm old, too.
Yeah. Okay. It's a show when they're, what was it, in Wisconsin? Yeah, Laura Ingalls and all those guys are people. But they always show the beginning with the horse and carriage, right? The family's riding on the prairie. We're going to talk about synergy. And a kid said to me, I remember one thing you said years and years ago. I spoke on Sunday, on Super Bowl Sunday, and I talked to this kid when he was in grade 8. And he now has two teenagers. So, yes, I'm old. And he said, Mr. Reed, which I admonish him, is Kavis. He said, I remember you made an analogy, and it has always stuck with me. He said, it didn't register to me logically, but it's always stuck with me. This is 20 years later. He said, you said to my class that synergy can best be described as take one horse and put 5,000 pounds behind him, and he pulls it. Put two horses together and put 15,000 pounds behind them, and together they pull it. Said, but one horse can max out at 5,000, you put two together and they did 15,000. The math just doesn't add up. But remember that covalent bond thing and the energy that's exerted when it breaks apart, when it actually reaches potential? That's synergy. Put two people, put three people of like mindedness and the like aim and the like focus, and you are be amazed at the duplication, the percentage of increase in productivity, the energy that is actually exerted together. In the workouts, when you're yelling at Colin to come on, give more, push it more, he goes from 500 bench press to 600 bench press. That synergy just accelerates his muscular distribution. Synergy. Wow, when you have that high-performing team and you guys all come together and that that energy can be nuclear because you're working together. A shared common goal. So you're right, Ryan. Sorry, Dale. I love you. You're right. That's zero to team. One can pull 5,000. Two can pull 15. Why? The math doesn't add up, Kavis. And lastly, they said, what was the last one? I'm going to test you. Do you remember? What was the last one? I'm going to test you. What was the last one? Yes! Yes! Empowerment. My Monday morning meetings with the team in Montreal, my immediate team, it's amazing. If you walk in, you'll think it's daddy daycare. None of the guys in there are old enough to shave yet. The young lady still looks like she's in elementary school. And then there's the guy that's been around since Methuselah. And then there's me, who's been around since dirt. And then there's right in between. And they're from all different backgrounds. Most of them are very young in football. And most people will say, man, did you put together a band of misfit? I got an all-star team. And we meet on Mondays to have a conversation. Then on Tuesday, we have a 30-minute meeting to see what has come of that conversation on Monday. And on my Tuesday meetings, I surprised everyone. This is a general manager speaking. I surprised everyone. And Colin, I remember you saying you're going to tell your team this in the car. So guys, he's going to tell you guys this in a few. I started the meeting by saying, guys, I want you to do your jobs. I've laid out clearly what your job descriptions are. None of you have said that it's not clear to you. All of you have signed off verbally or through your reactions that it's clear to you. So therefore, I now trust that you're going to go out and execute your jobs. And here's what I want you to have in your back pocket. I don't care if it costs the club money that you made a mistake. There was that gasp of silence. And the young lady who's keeping the budget went, really? I don't care if you make a mistake. Go and do your jobs. If it cost us, not that much money, but if it cost us a couple of $1,000s for you to make a mistake and no one gets hurt by it, the organization is going to be stronger for it. But do your jobs. What did I just do for them? What did I just do for them, Jan? Is Jan or Jen? Jan. What did I just do for them? They're empowered now. My life is made a lot easier. They know that I got their back, that they can go out now freely, legally, safely, and do their jobs. And by me saying, I don't mind if you cost us a few dollars, guess what they're going to be more apt not to do? Say it. What? Yes. I'm going to tell you, I have the smartest women, the second smartest woman. My mom is probably the smartest. She is brilliant. And she knows how to push my buttons. And she'll say this, go ahead and spend as much as you want. Go ahead, just do what you need to do. You know what she's telling me? I know you're not. I'm just telling you you can. Because when you're given permission to do it, you're not going to do it. You're more conscientious of it. But it's just the fact that she empowered me with the card to be able to do it makes me feel good, right? Colin told me he's going to let you guys know that you guys can do whatever you need to do and don't worry about money. He told me that.
That's what exactly what I was saying. Now everyone's got an idea.
Empowerment, right? I'm going to close and open it up for questions with this. And I want you to think about your construct of a team. I want you to think about the highest performing team that you've ever seen. I want you to think about it. What was your thought on the highest performing team you've ever seen? Do you have an example of that? Is the New England Patriots, is the Saskatchewan Roughriders? You're not a sports person? You ever seen it in just, I'm going to call it sports, not real life. Have you ever seen it in real life? Ever been a part of an organization like that?
I think one of my first jobs was very much like that. And it was family run too. Maybe that's.
Yes, interesting. What is the NBA going to say about the family run one, Colin? Why is he successful? What say you, Mr. NBA?
Loyalty.
Yes. And that big O word. What's the big O? Ownership. It's family ran, so there's ownership distributed amongst the workers. And when you're in an ownership position, you're more apt to give more. You're more into it. You rent or own your place?
It was a family I used to work.
Yeah. No, your house now. You rent or own it?
I rent.
Do you have a lot of parties over there?
No, never.
Never? Do you take care of it like it's your own?
Yeah.
I shouldn't ask a female that question. Do you rent or own? Say rent, Mick. Just play with me. Rent, right? Yeah, you rent. How do you take care of your apartment? Could be better. So we walked in there. It's a health hazard. We're stepping over stuff. We're kicking the dog out of the way and all this stuff because he's all over, his bones all over the place, right? Right? Parties every night. Just play along with it, right? So when you own your house, are you going to have me over for a party?
Maybe a small
party. Why? Because you own it, right? It means more to you. When teams sell ownership, the stakeholders and the shareholders are more vested in it, and there's a stronger bond. Sell ownership. Give me your example, Anders. of a high performing team.
Right now, I'd say the people that I work with.
Wow. What group are you with?
PCL.
They are an extraordinary company, one of the highest safety standards in the industry. Reputed for their safety standards, correct? Reputed for how they do business. That's why you guys get all the high contracts, right?
Right.
What makes it so good? Give us some state secrets. Don't worry.
We won't tell anyone.
You can trust us.
I think it's like you talked about the ownership. You bought into the company. One of us succeeds, we all succeed. One of us grows.
Outstanding. Can I come work for you? Colin already told me when the football gig's up, I can come work for his organization, that he will make a spot for me, give me whatever I ask, and I don't even have to show up. So his employees can now spend whatever they want to spend, and I can be employed but not be employed. So we're good. I love that, man. I'm going to call on you. You know I'm going to call on you, Mr. Twitter. Give me your example of a team, the highest performing team.
I think I would have to say it's the marketing company. Everybody is committed to it because they're owners. They all have ownership. I brought them in for that particular reason. I gave them a part of the business so that they can be a team where everybody had a vested interest. And we all have common goals. And so a lot of what you've been saying about really runs through. That's what we strive for. That's what we aim for. Can't say we always achieve it, but we manage to get it back together and pull ourselves together. That's where we go.
Is it Mike?
Yep.
You've been pondering. Give me your example. Lost to Carolina, right? Tar Marchant. Was Doug Wade on that team and Bill Guerin and those guys then? Yeah. Who was the goalie? Who was the goalie? I'm about to be ran out of town because I don't know. I know a lot about hockey, but sometimes I forget the goalie because I don't pay attention to him that much. Sorry, goalies. But I'm going to piggyback off what you said. And I'm going to use a CFL analogy. Stop record, because this might get me fired. I'm going to say a sterling example of a high-performing team. I was just kidding about that, by the way. Is the Calgary Stampeders. Don't throw anything. Be safe. Put your hands down. I see. Name me any CFL aficionados in here. Come on, who follows CFL religiously? There are no Riders fans in here? There are two of you? Just the Riders, and you're not a CFL fan. You follow CFL? I'm gonna ask you, name me two star players in the Calgary Stampeders. Name me three star players on this Calgary Stampeders team. That's my point. Who was the best team in the league last year? Calgary. As a coach, we walked on the field and we were about to warm up. You know the stretching stuff we do? And I stood there in awe. I didn't recognize too many of the names, but I felt, oh my God, this is a great team. The way they warmed up. The energy that they had. the synchronicity in terms of their movements, and almost you can see that they're in sync thought-wise. I'm like, this is a great team. But I can identify a lot of the guys with the back of their jerseys. And I'm gonna give away some business secret, probably get fired for this, but Colin's gonna hire me. They have almost the lowest payroll. Remember we go back, talent's not enough? 16 games in a row? We ended that streak, by the way. I guess they're second team, but we'll take it. But not a lot of star players, low payroll, and arguably the best team because they had it. That's like the 2006 Oilers team. That's like the Chicago Blackhawks. Why would I say the Chicago Blackhawks? You're a hockey fan. Why would I say the Chicago Blackhawks? They built that team in Chicago. Jonathan Taves, Patrick Kane, Seabrook. They built that team. People are not patient enough to allow teams to be built. What do you want right away when you buy a season ticket? Right now. Remember we go back to that dynasty thing? We want it right now. Whatever happens when you do something fast. Does it always turn out when you bake a cake, does it turn out when you do it fast? You decide, I'm gonna turn it up to 550, forget that 350 thing, let's just do it right now. Does it usually work out? Seldom, right? But when you buy that ticket, as an observer, as a fan, you want it right now. But the Chicago Blackhawks, through the draft, smart free agent signing, and then when they felt they're right there, they're almost there, they went out and they got Marian Gabbert. It was Hossa. They added just that piece. Bam! Corey Crawford was the goalie, right? There goes championships, right? Because they did it right. They were patient. And it's not scientifically true, but it's an analogy often used. Where do diamonds come from? Pardon? What does it start out being? Coal. Yeah. And what makes it a diamond? Pressure and time. God, Twitter. Just can't wait for the information. Can't pick up the paper anymore. My daughter should not be mistreated by Nordstrom. Last one. Give me your example. Come on. Yes. No, I've already called on you. Brilliant, yes. You scratching your collar? Yes. Give me your example. No, I miss hockey, miss CFL? Yes. I can't see from that far. Is it Bernie? Bonnie. What's your example? Last one. You get to close the show. I'm sorry, I did not hear it.
Saskatchewan Rush.
Okay. Yes. Western RV owns them, right? I look at the business side of it too much, I guess. They've been very successful. Why do you think that is? Why do you think that they didn't enjoy that success in Edmonton? I love you, Bonnie. I love lacrosse. Don't tell too many people that. I love that game. It's so exciting. it's always moving. There's always the strategy behind it. The line changes when they go from offense to defense, the setups. And man, is it ever coming when they let go. And I watched a lot of rush games. And then I heard about the success they enjoyed in Regina. Saskatoon, correct. But I want you to do a little research for me. I don't know the answer to this. This is just speculation and conjecture on my part. But please do the research on this, Bonnie. You love lacrosse, right? Love it. Research the team, the names that were on that team when they came to Regina. And whether or not it was they were the same people on that team when they were in Edmonton, or about a 75% retention. Would you do that for me? Here's what I'm going to suggest. Environment has a lot to do with success. And you used a word that is so key in a successful team environment, expectation. Did the New England Patriots expect to win or lose that game on Sunday? What say you? Did they expect to win or lose it? Did you watch it? What do you think they expected? They expected to win. The environment that was created is that of expectation. Burning that boat again. The expectation changed when they left Edmonton. Half-hearted fan support, pretty much taken for granted. We're the big city, we have the Oilers, we have everything else. Lacrosse, why? We're not paying $2,000, so it can't be a good game, right? Isn't that the mentality? If it's not costing a lot, it's not good. Remember that? That's a marketing strategy, right? See what the tolerance is, and I'll just keep jacking up the price until, because it's more expensive, it has to be better. You come here and you guys just support it. It's the Roughriders. Camera off. I remember as a player, if you had a broken ankle the week that you're playing the Roughriders, you're taping it up. You're playing. That's your stat game. Everyone wanted to play against Saskatchewan. Awful team. If your arm was broken, hey, Doc, just cast it up. I can make it. We're going to be good. One arm out there, it's going to be okay. Almost overnight, the franchise went from almost being non-existent. And I remember those days. A lot of you Riders fans don't want to remember those days. The franchise went from almost being non-existent, almost overnight, to an expectation of winning Grey Cups. Am I lying to you? I remember those days. And a lot of Riders fans, I always laugh at. I go, are you a true fan or are you just jumping on the bandwagon? Because I remember when we came here, there were about 5,000 people in the stands. I call those the true fans. But the expectation changed. The mentality changed. And the win started to come. You were still playing in old Taylor Field. That's what we call it, right? Has it changed? Mosaic Stadium was Taylor Field. It's still the multicolored bleachers, still a bad locker room, still a hard turf. But bam! And now you guys will pay $1,000 if I put Rough Rider logo on this piece of paper. Remind me to do that. I've never seen it. You put a Rough Rider sticker on anything and you guys will pay whatever you want, they ask for it. But less than 20 years ago, you couldn't give away a ticket. But the expectations changed. If you guys have any questions, I will stand here and answer. But if not, here are my parting words. One is too small a number to be great. And in order to be a high-performing, high-achieving team, you have to clearly communicate the vision. You have to clearly communicate expectations. You have to have an environment of trust. There has to be that 100% authenticity, that sincerity. There has to be a communal environment. And there also has to be
and empowerment of the people in it. My time is up. I'm gonna go steal some free agents and get on a plane and head back to Montreal. God bless you guys.
Anyone real quick have any questions? Wait, we entertain a couple?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
my flight is 9 to 7:30.
We haven't got a microphone.
I was just going to ask, you mentioned, you know, the stretching and the synergy with, what team was it? I can't remember.
Calgary Stampeders.
So I just want to know some of the rituals that you've kind of had in the past or have now and why they're important.
Oh. People call them superstition, but a lot of high-performing athletes get into a mindset of routine. And that routine is bedded in stasis, creating an environment of stasis, of calm, where you're in that proverbial zone. So much so that if you put your socks on at 1 o'clock for a 1:30 game, you put your socks on at 1 o'clock. And it's not superstition, it's that you've been trained so systematically and so methodically that you have a routine. Before Colin lifts that 600 pounds that he's gonna bench press, he probably has a routine that he goes through because that routine has been a part of his training. It's a part of him. And so those are the kinds of things we do. For me, I have a ritual as a coach of running up the stairs at a certain time. And people know that 35 minutes before kickoff, Kavis is gonna be running the steps. Don't bother Kavis. And if I get bothered or stopped or something, my routine is thrown off and I feel out of stasis. And when you feel out of stasis as an athlete, as a coach, you're not putting yourself in that optimal zone. Anyone ever heard of being in the zone? And I know you've been there. You can't describe it. How many have ever been in the zone? Oh man, anything you touch, it's like having the Midas touch, turns into gold. It just worked. And you know what? Scientifically, just can't explain it. But here's what I accredit it to. It's those habits and rituals and routines. You know what happens? It becomes so much a part of you that you do it without even thinking about it. And when you're in that zone, it's because you've been there before. Your mind has been prepared, either consciously or subconsciously prepared for those moments. And it just happens. It just happens. So much for as an example, as a player, I would tell teammates, watch this. Watch this. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Next play, something good happens. Because you're expecting, you've seen it before, you've been there. You've prepared your body and mind so much that you can put yourself in that zone. Does that answer your question? Clearly? Yes! Anyone else? Pardon? Yes, what time do you run those stairs at? I'm not telling you again because I know you're gonna try to break the routine. And the last thing I wanna say about the routines and habits about what happened with the New England Patriots, I think it was the Super Bowl when the alarm went off, the Pittsburgh game, the fire alarm went off. Before the game and stuff. We all know the Patriots did that, I'm just kidding. Somebody who wanted the Patriots to win did that.
Disrupted the flow, yeah.
And you know what they were doing? Disrupting the flow, because that routine's broken, right? That habit that you had is broken. Anything else? Guys, you've been fantastic. It has been an honor being in Regina the last 3 days, and I thank you, my friend.
Thank you, buddy. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Just a couple closing things. First of all, Kavis really did me a favor. When we talked about going, that was before he got a new job and got busy, but he made him sure I'll come out and spend a couple days here. And then he got a new job, and I thought, oh, this kind of changes things because he's going to run from this room and head back to the other and start negotiating some more contracts. He has been extremely busy, and I really appreciate him not just making the commitment to come here, but just pouring his heart
he's basically got an office now in our building. So, and he's been borrowing offices and all
drinking
sorts of
coffee.
Drinking the coffee. So, yeah, the only thing we needed to do is actually give you part of our uniform here. So, Kavis, you come on. Is everything inside here?
Yeah.
We got a little gift for you. Oh. We got a little gift for you here, and to make sure it's. In case you cut your finger, I got a little first aid kit for you, but you got one of our team jackets here. And I just want to thank you again on behalf of the team and behalf of everybody here, all right? If you want to, again, we're going to have this on probably online next couple, 3 weeks, figure, Laura, somewhere like that maybe. And we'll get a message out to everybody so you know that. Kavis has also yesterday did a live 10-minute segment, I guess, on Ralco Radio, but also a half-hour Ask the Experts panel, specifically focusing on construction safety. It'll be airing, Laura, March 4th. Oh, okay. Okay, March 4th, the expert panel, and something else is running live.
The 7-minute green zone.
Oh, okay, the 7-minute green zone will be running live today, and then there'll be an expert panel. But we'll send something out here so you know what's coming up. And it was a great conversation, and just sitting in the studio, but we wanted to get that out to the broad community. There's a lot of stuff for consumers, business owners, others who are involved in one aspect or other of the construction sector. So last things, I don't know how many folks know our staff. If you don't know our staff, make sure you say hi. That seems like, well, the team is kind of congregated here, but make sure you mix and mingle. We've got some magazines here and other products at the back of the room. So grab your chapstick, because my lips and skin have been cracked in the last couple days. Other than that, thank you so much for coming. Really appreciate it. And you guys take care of driving home. God bless.
My Twitter friend. Have a good one. Yes.